Hi, Cheryl. Hi, Conley. PK. All right, I'll just bring PK up already. A little past our time to start. I think I've accepted.
Hey. Hello, sir. Hey, good to see you. You look so
Good
well.
to see you too.
You look so well.
Thanks, sir.
How have you
I mean,
been?
some a lot of thanks to my wife as well. She's
Yes,
making
she's
work.
taking good care of you. Good care of you. How are the twins?
They are very well. They are very well.
Awesome.
Yes, sir.
Awesome.
Yes, sir.
Beautiful. Yeah, man.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for honoring this. For the first time in my life, I think I would have experienced what maybe John the Baptist experienced, for him to have said he couldn't untie the lace of Jesus' sandal. I've never had that feeling, until last night. I'm like, what?
Really?
But it's good to have you, sir. So good
All
to have
pleasure,
you.
Yvette. All pleasure, with all pleasure.
That's all.
I feel blessed to be doing this with you. Awesome.
Thank you
awesome.
So much. Right. So this has been running, in line with a series I started, Business Productivity Series. And what has been ongoing is we grew from purpose and business, how people can, switch from what they discover as skills or gifts or things they are interested in and turn them into businesses. And then we move from there to personal branding, the idea that people are able to create, of themselves, a level of attention that other people be willing to connect with, both personally and, in social space. And then we move from there to the business of entrepreneurship, which is, deals with the idea of the things you need to do to ensure that you are really running a business. The fact that businesses don't just happen, people actually do some work, and then we try to, through different, speakers at that, for that session, make people realize the kind of work that those people have had to do to grow their businesses to the levels they've gotten to, and to scale and all of that. Today, the session is tagged Playing Global.
Awesome.
And so I'd like to speak in, in two different, directions, which I would, mention. But guys, welcome. First of all, I'd like to introduce my mentor. The truth is I would have just been lost with any other person, because I've had that interest in, being out there helping people, get inspired to be the best of themselves. And of course, I've had exposure to several other people before I met you. I'm sure you remember how I met you. And the moment I decided there was no need having a distraction with some other voice when I've seen the voice. So this is not to even say anything out of proportion. I'm sure you know, right? And then I'm very, very happy that you made it here. So guys, you want to put together your parts. We've been doing that, your pens, and then be ready to get blown out of your seats, right? But as much as possible, in the blowing out, please take notes, right? You need it, right? All right, so PK, I'd like you to express to two different people, and then we close up with the tag, right? The tag is, how people get to scale to start playing global. But the first set of people that I'd like you to, speak to are people that currently are even finding it tough to, create, balance with what they've discovered that they would like to engage, as businesses, right? People that are still clueless about how to create a niche for themselves or even fit into their market. What are the things that they need to consider? What are the things they need to pay attention to? What are the things they need to do? Right, we can start from there.
Thank you so much, Ife. Again, it's a pleasure and an awesome privilege to be identified with anything you're trying to do. You are someone with an amazing, incredible spirit.
Thank you, sir.
And an excellent culture radiates around everything you do. I saw that from day one. And it has been my honor and my privilege to contribute in any way to the big picture that is in your head. You are somebody always with a big picture and a helicopter view. I celebrate you and all you represent. I know it's not a matter of time that this world will unlock its gratitude towards all that is inside of you, you know, Amen. As you share them with the world. So thank you Amen. For sharing, and thank you for being strong. There's a lot to say, you know, in right. this season for guys who are still trying to ideate. So I will put all of what you describe as those who are still trying to ideate. People right. who are not clear about what they should be doing, you know. And see, but what they need to realize is that there's no time for that. You know, there's no time to experiment. You know,
right.
you got to be clear and you got to move, right? Mm-hmm. And part of that is that if you are ready, you are late. So you also don't want to camp around the idea of solidifying something or fine-tuning or being perfect or being ready. You know, it's not for you to decide what the market would take or not. It's for the market to decide. A lot of entrepreneurs, you know, leave that decision to themselves, and it's what I call entrepreneurial arrogance. You know, you don't decide what to take to the market in your boardroom or in your you know strategy room. You decide what to take to the market with the market perspective, right? So if you check the idea and you believe that the idea has passed some basic standards or protocol, then the idea should get out there. The market will tell you if it's the right idea or not. And if it is not, they will not pay for it. They don't pay for it. You go back to the drawing board, re-strategize, learn from that experience, and then refire again. Right? But there are some things to watch out for in creating an idea today. The first one is recognizability, right? You need to think about recognizability. It means whatever you are trying to bring to market, it has to pass the test of recognizability. People need to see that idea and recognize what it is about. I'm not even saying they need to recognize that it's good for them, but they need to be able to see that idea. You need to present the idea in a format that people can recognize. Now, there's no other way to define that except to define it through technology. So one thing is you got to be tech-oriented, right? I've said it before, and I'll say it again. We're going to speak less and less of democracy as we move into the future, into this decade and the decades after it. We're going to speak less and less about democracy. We're going to speak more and more about technocracy, right? And technocracy, essentially, is a system where all ideas are driven by technology and managed by technologists, right? MBA degrees and all of those certifications will continue to be relevant, but there will be an overriding element of technological intelligence or awareness that will surround all of that MBA or whatever type of awareness you have or skill you have to be able to interpret ideas, right, in the 2020s and to move them forward. So it's going to be about technocracy. I said we're going to speak less and less of developing or developed nations. We're going to speak more and more about smarter and smartest countries, smartest nations, right? Because tech has come to stay. And part of what I've also said is that with or without COVID, the world was going to embrace tech in all of its weight. Anyway, COVID in all its fatality is just slowing down the system. I mean, I cannot overemphasize that. So that those who are out of the loop can catch up. So you want to see this season as a catch-up season. You want to solidify your idea. So the beginning is how do you bring technology into what you do? And to explain that in the most lay way, is to say, before now, if you are a hospital, for example, you are a hospital using technology to treat people. You are a hospital that is using tech to treat people. And the tech you use is essentially limited to gadgets or equipment. In other words, X-ray machines, MRI scan machines, you know, and stuff like that, you know, that allow you to be able to diagnose effectively, probably treat some, you know, and all of that, you know. But now there's a little shift. You are no longer a hospital that is using tech to treat people. You are now a tech organization that is treating people, right? You are no longer using tech, you are now tech yourself. And I use hospital because it's the most extreme example I can use. So if I can call a hospital a tech organization, then you can imagine what I would call somebody selling shoes or somebody selling, you know, any other thing. You know, all ideas must now be built on the foundation of tech. What that means is that before now, we use what we do offline. The hospital, as a case in point, will be what we do is in the physical hospital. It's like the physical hospital will be the front door to what we do. Then we use tech or online as the back door to what we do. But that is flipped now. Today, online is the front door to what we do. Offline is the back door to what we do. Okay? So if you are speaking about recognizability, you have to be highly public. You have to be highly public. And to be highly public, you have to be massively elastic. Right? And to be that elastic, tech is the only thing that can give you that advantage. The meaning of that essentially is that if you are a beverage company, I like to use that example. If you are a beverage company and you produce water, But if you produce water and in that same factory, you actually have potential to produce any beverage, including soda, or, you know, soft drink, beer, juice, wine. You can produce all of that, plus or minus a few equipment, you can produce all of those things, right? But because you are already producing water as with your factory, you have capacity. As you dominate the water space, you can shift to juice space. As you dominate that, you can shift to soda. From soda, you can shift to... So you have that option. You have that liberty around you because you are in a positioning that is elastic in itself. Now, in that sense, I'm saying that is what tech gives you. So when you are a tech organization first, it means you have increased your capacity to not only diversify into different blocks, you know, or different niches, you are also able to scale more easily because essentially, if you take Amazon as a case in point, which I've used several times, Amazon has stores offline. People need to know that Amazon has a lot of stores offline, right? Where else is offline? But nobody has seen those offline stores. Neither do anybody cares to see those offline stores. What you want is you need to get your products to you. So what do? Amazon has camped online. Online is the front door into Amazon. But everything Amazon is selling, pushing, their supply chain, logistics, everything is offline. But that is not your business. Your business is they know they need to be highly public. They need to be recognizable. And so they need to be elastic and visible. So that gives them that advantage. And then with online as your front door, you can trade globally. You can now trade beyond the limits of your geography. You can stretch beyond the limits of your geography. So you can attract purchasing power from Brazil, from Lagos, from Johannesburg, from Nairobi, Mombasa, Addis Ababa, the United Kingdom, Ontario, Calgary, Brussels, from all over the world. But your masquerade is dancing on one spot. I call it borderlessness. Borderlessness is the ability of the human spirit to, from one spot, attract purchasing power and value from all over the world and bring it to headquarters, you know, where he is, you know, impacting directly on GDP per capita income. That is the type of way that businesses have to think. So whatever idea people are trying to form, they have to ask, how does this idea pass the test of recognizability? How does it transcend the limits of my geography? It doesn't make sense anymore if you are in Africa, for example, to be earning money in naira or in cedis or in some local currency or in rand, you know, you got to transcend that. The economy is now wider. What stops you from collecting money in Chicago? What stops you from collecting money in New York or in Dallas or in United Kingdom or in France, Paris, or in Germany? What stops you from doing that? Online, nothing stops you. You don't pay duties, you don't pay export duties or import duties, you don't pay anything. The world is free. The next time you are promoting a new product on your Facebook page, instead of picking your geography, pick Dallas. Let people in Dallas see it. Of course, you must have built a supply chain that ensures that if somebody orders the good in Berlin, you know, you can move it from them from Addis Ababa straight to Berlin. So you want to tidy all of that up, and then there are delivery companies that are available to make that happen. What stops you from registering a business in the United States? What stops you from having a U.S. bank account, of having, you know, so that you can be trusted more? Because when you come to your payment gateway and people see your local brands in Africa, it may just arouse their suspicion, you know, because of the energy of trust. But if you have a U.S. setup, you have a U.S. bank account, and all of what you are using to trade on e-commerce platform is from the U.S., you are trusted more. And then, so you could gain more trust within your own space and beyond your own space. So it has to pass the test of recognizability. It has to pass the test of usability. People must be able to use this idea. People must be able to change their lives aligned with their new preferences, because right now people are forming new habits, and they are forming those habits without their permission.
Annoyingly,
they are not even aware they are forming new habits. It is after lockdown when people go out and they realize that, oh, I don't like doing that anymore. I don't like doing that anymore. So you want to sit in the head of people to pretty much photograph or predict what their preferences and prejudices are, because customer preference is now superior to customer satisfaction. Because satisfaction can only be measured after the person has engaged your idea, bought your product, and then you watch him behave before you measure satisfaction. Mm-hmm. Preference is, he has not even bought your stuff.
He has not even bought it.
So how do you know he's not even buying it?
You
measure satisfaction. So keep satisfaction to one side and think of customer preference, first of all. How do I get where this guy wants to go? And how do I arrest his purchasing power by aligning my idea with what he wants to buy? So once you pass the test of recognizability and usability, then you must pass the test of transferability, right? How does this idea move all over the world easily, seamlessly? I'm making an example that if you bring, you look at pasta. Pasta is an Italian delicacy. It's not even an European delicacy. It's not an American delicacy. It's an Italian delicacy that has passed the test of recognizability, it has passed the test of usability, and it has passed the test of transferability. So automatically, it has passed the test of rewardability. So what is happening is, anybody can move pasta from all over the world. As a matter of fact, Dangote is an African, and he's selling pasta, and he's making billions selling the delicacy of another culture. Right? He's not, they don't even know that delicacy in Europe. They don't even know the Dangote pasta in Europe, but they know it all over Africa. He is an African. So Tuwo can go global. Amalaya can go global. You know, Emba can go global. But for them to go global, somebody has to say, how did they pass the test of recognizability? Seeing it on one spot and knowing this thing is valuable. Now, is it valuable to me? Then the test of usability. It's valuable to me. Can it reach me? The test of transferability. Once it passed the test of, do I know what it is that it is valuable? Yes. Recognizability. Can it be of value to me? Usability. Can it reach me? Transferability. Automatically, it becomes rewardable. Then it passed the test of rewardability. I think if we put ideas within that block, you know, we'll be able to find what we should go to market with. And in going to market, there are also five other questions to ask. So when you are clear about the idea, now how do we go? The next question is, after passing those four tests, the next question is, where is the money? So where is the money of this idea? You know, who is holding this money? When I say who, I don't mean one individual. I mean what demographic? You know, are they young? Are they old? When are they awake? When are they buying? Is it in the night? Is it in the money? What times are they? Where do I find them? Are they in every country? At what time? In what time zone? You know, what's their texture of taste? How do they think? You know, so how do they behave? Are they millennials? Are they Gen Z? Is it a combination of all? So what is the demographic? Where is the money? who is holding it? How do I reach this person? I don't mean one individual, but how do I reach this demographic? How do I reach them? Where is the money? Who is holding it? How do I reach him? If I reach him, what do I say? You know, that's another symposium discussion. I put out a webinar called Ideological Messaging. Ideological messaging. The replay is available for purchase, but it's talking about how to speak, to pitch your ad copies, your narratives, your communication, your stories. How do you say it today? You just don't say it anyhow, because there's a new. All thought leaders and all research institutes have all agreed that Generation Z is far more critical and useful to businesses today than millennials. So even millennials have pretty much run their course. They are now a secondary constituency. The primary constituency for consumption all over the world now, even for workforce management, for business penetration, for market penetration, and all of that, you have to think about Gen Z. The oldest Gen Z is 23 years old today. So these guys in 10 years, in 20 years, are going to be the force in the system. So the question is, how do you get these guys on your side? So what do you say to them? What do they want? Who are they? You need to profile them. They like accountability. They like transparency. They like to rally around an idea or a cause. They are natural rebels. You know, they like freedom. 60% of them want to be entrepreneurs. You know, they want transparency. They want, you know, all of these things are there. They are restless. You know, they are tech savvy. You know, and so how do you get these guys on your side? Where is the money? Who is holding it? How do I reach them? If I reach them, what do I say? If I know what to say, how do I say it? Do I need a podcast? Do I need a blog? Do I need a brochure? Do I need to build a one-page website? Do I need click funnel? Do I even need digital marketing at all? You know, what do I need? How do I go about this thing? Do I need to make promotions? Do I need to make videos? What do I need to do? How do I reach these guys? You know, I think when we pass the test of recognizability, usability, transferability, and rewardability, we shift to asking those questions. Every time we ask and answer those questions carefully and intelligently, we birth a market. So for those who are still trying to look for what to do, they should try and get this thing I just explained and unpack it for themselves, and they'll be clear about how to position.
Wow. I mean, that's a lot said, you know, you know, I think it has even delved into the second question. You know, the second question I was going to ask, like, you know, people that have even gotten to, so let's even say they claim that they've gotten to what they would say the highest level, you know, of dominance in their current industry, right? And it seems like they're currently now jogging on a spot. So I'll say a quick example. I know that there are a couple of people that are into maybe public speaking, people that are, you know, acclaimed thought leaders, you know, but they've dominated the local Nigeria, for example, right? And it doesn't seem as if their thoughts or their work is usable outside the borders of Nigeria, you know? And it now begins to seem like they're just jogging on a spot. Right, there are other people too that, you know, they are known, they're recognized already locally, you know, but that's about what it is, right? These are the same principles they engage, or, you know, how do they even invent themselves, you know, for global use or global space or global relevance?
Clear. So part of what they need to know is that global was an option. Today is a duty. You see, before now, it was a choice to go global. You can choose not to go global, and you'll be fine. There are many businesses who will not need to go global, and you'll be fine. Today, and I can bet you that 80% of businesses will have to think global. Now, when you think global, it first of all means that, because if you come to the United States to open a store, and only your people are paying you, you are a Ghanaian, and only Ghanaians are buying your idea. You are a Nigerian, and only Nigerians are buying your idea. You are Belgian, and only Belgians are buying your idea. You are not global. You are just international, in that you have crossed a border, And you have now been able to offer a little consolation to your type of people.
You are just a local that has opened
kiosk in a different geography, and you are offering comfort and exchange to your type of people. You are not global yet. So you have a lot of businesses from Nigeria here, but their only customers are still Nigerians. So they are not global. Global is when people of diverse cultures are receiving your idea and paying for your idea. So it's not just Japanese who pay for Toyota. It's not just Americans who pay for Microsoft Windows. It's not just, you get me? It's not just Americans who go into McDonald's. Everybody, the Chinese, the French, everybody goes into McDonald's. So when you say you are a global idea, it means people of diverse culture, different tongues and language, just like the gospel. The gospel is not a Jewish phenomenon. Everybody from all over the world, Germans, Americans, even Islam, you have, American Muslims, you have British Muslims, you have Muslims all over, Buddhism, you have Chinese people who are Buddhists, you have Indians who are Buddhists, you have Nigerians who are Buddhists, you have all of that. So an idea, capitalism is not being practiced by its founders alone. Democracy came from Europe. It's not just being practiced. In fact, the king democratic nation in the world today is not an European country, the United States of America. So the idea is, it's not until when you have something that people of diverse cultures are not trading with, you are not global. Number two, being global also is good for you because problem in location A can be comforted by prosperity in location B. So, if, for example, you are doing business in Accra or in Mombasa or in Dakar, right? If you have any business challenge in your environment in Dakar, prosperity with your business in Johannesburg can comfort the losses in Dakar. Prosperity in New York can comfort what you are doing or the problem you are having in the United Kingdom. So, it is no longer an option. The third reason is because today, borderlessness has melted geography. Technology is an instrument for the rise of people everywhere. Globalization was a good suggestion, but it was an unfair articulation in that it favored countries who have already transcended the limits of visa. Countries like the United States, the first world countries. First world countries can move their ideas easily from their country to Africa. But it's not easy for Africans to move their ideas, products, and services to Europe or to America because they will have to, first of all, deal with the limits of visa. Now, I tell people that the moment you take yourself to a level where you transcend the limits of visa, because when the Bible said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, there was no visa in the world. Nobody had a visa. It was something you could do at the speed of thought. The Lord did not say spread and fill the earth by getting a visa. You know, there was nothing like that. You are supposed to be able to fill the earth, move around the world at the speed of choice, not at the approval of a third party. And so when you take yourself to a level where your operations transcend the limits of visa, it's not relocation, it's not traveling, it's first of all restoration. You have restored yourself back to that original man in Genesis chapter 1 who had the right and the freedom to move his idea around the world without the limits of visa. So technology gives you that opportunity now. I can be in any country from where I am right now. I can be in Canada online. I can be in France. I can sell goods to guys in Belgium without leaving my location. The guy in Accra can sell ideas to the guys in Banjul without leaving the location. Technology is the new weapon for the underdog. It defeats, is the next level. It gives us the instrument to defeat the limits of globalization. So borderlessness is the upgrade of the concept of globalization because it's a level playing field and technology is its weapon. I did an entire work, which we know about, in 2018 about borderlessness, four audio parts. It's on my space. People can go check it out. Learn.kidensjuniorstore.com. They could check it out and download it. You know, of course, it fees attached to that, but it teaches everything people need to understand about borderlessness. Borderlessness is the upgrade of globalization. We are going to speak more and more of that word as we go into the future. So that is how people need to think, and that is how they need to operate. And then again, like I said earlier, it doesn't make sense anymore to if you are in third world Africa, it doesn't make sense anymore to continue to earn within the limits of your geography. Look at the Naira. Nigeria is the King Kong of Africa. But look at the Naira. Just look at the Naira. I mean, I tell anybody anywhere in Africa, I don't care where you are in Africa. If you are in Banjul, if you are in Dakar, Addis Ababa, Burkina Faso, wherever you are, the challenges with Nigeria is a signal to your own pressure. And so when you see the flag Nigeria is raising, the challenge with the Naira, with 500 bucks to a dollar now, you want to unseat yourself and get uncomfortable and ask yourself, how do I begin to earn in dollars or in euro or in pounds? And technology gives you that ability. Now you need to become tech correct by reinventing and re-engineering your entire processes and make sure that you build systems that can protect that. And because if you don't do that anyway, the guys in London are coming for your market in Africa. Eh?
Right.
The guys in the United Kingdom, the guys in the US are coming for your market anyway. So you better go and wrestle. Your competition before now used to be the guy on the next street. But your competition now is not the guy on the next street, it's the guy in Houston. It's the guy in Rio de Janeiro. It's the guy in Moscow. It's the guy in Berlin that is challenging you now. So you have to seek that, wear that large cap and position right for that.
Right. Wow. Guys, well, I hope that people have been catching stuff. If you have questions, I'll take just a few. Also, I would like you to, maybe just shed light on a few industries. I'm sure that there are people here that probably run fashion. How do they plug in? How do they expand this thing? How do they move from the frontiers of just Nigerian exchange? How do they go past without even leaving the border? People probably, we can pick maybe just two or three industries.
Yeah, great.
Something
great.
That fleshes out on those ones, and then other people can pick from there. How
First of all, I'm going to say a few things real quick. One, I'm going to challenge everybody to be a monopoly. Be a monopoly. And stop competing. Create a niche for yourself. Remember Amazon. Amazon did not begin by doing all that they are doing now. When Amazon began, all they were selling was books. People forget that. It was just books they were selling. They mastered that area, conquered it, then they moved to cities. Then they conquered that area. So start with a niche. Conquer a niche. Dominate a niche, right? And move from there. I put that also in my webinars. I'm going to tell everybody, go and find those webinars. I've done how many now? I think about four or five webinars now. The webinars were free, but the replays are charged. So go check it out and go get it. I did a lot of expose on all of this. On the industries, I'm going to quickly pick on which one should I start with? Fashion. You mentioned fashion already.
Yeah.
So let me start with fashion. So fashion, for example, Africa is selling. Fashion designers in Africa need to know that Africa is selling all over the world for some reason. Maybe for whatever the reason is, people are buying Africa right now. And so, as an African designer, you have never had a better chance than now. So part of what you want to do is, if you can look for, collaborate and create an app, find encourage people to create an app that can allow for precision measurement across borders, so that the guy in London can easily take his measurement, and then you know, you can do it from Lagos, and then you can have the measurement of the guy in London and then produce to precision, right? Of course, you are going to pass all the other tests of recognizability, usability, transferability. You must pass all of that. You must pass all the question of the five questions. Where is the money? Who is holding it? How do you reach it? Read what you say. If not, you say, what do you say? You have to clear all of that as well. But beyond that also, you also need to ask that, okay, it's fashion. How do I take measurement with precision? All those ideas of I can look at somebody and know why, that's too primitive. So what you want to do is get some, let market trust you, right, and do that. Some other people, we need to think like events companies, interior decorators. They will have to think luxury. Luxury market is fantastic because, like I've said before, we're in a recession globally. The head of IMF already said the whole world's already in a recession. So, and when there's a recession, what it means pretty much is there's no, there's really no opportunities, or opportunities have shrunk massively. So opportunities are shrunk, it also means that purchasing power has also shrunk. So a lot of purchasing power have left the 99% and is now in the hand of the 1%. So you want to also focus on the 1%. What do I produce for the 1%? What do I create for the 1%? So you need to rebrand to make sure that you can position rightly so that the 1% can find you attractive and worthy of sending their resources your way, you know, kind of thing. So that's what I would say about that. Some other people will need to get creative. The guys in the thought leadership space have to understand that we probably have said goodbye to physical gathering as we know it, because even when the lockdown is off in many countries, it will still take us another 1 year before they can permit 2,000 people to gather, before they can allow 5,000 people to gather, 1,000 people to gather. So we have to find another way to communicate in that value, and that is also coming online. And we need to also understand that, you know, before, when people think of your work as a thought leader, they think of the guys within your space. But now, the same investment of time, energy, and resources to reach you in Lagos is all I need to reach Tom Peters in the USA. So why should I pay for you when I can pay for Tom Peters? So all of those challenges have come, and people need to look at that as well. You know,
somebody said real estate.
What other industry is there?
Someone said real estate. Someone mentioned real estate. Real estate.
Yeah, real estate is the same. Real estate is going to continue to grow because real estate in Africa, is particularly in Nigeria, is artificial market. It's not a real market, and so it's not going to be disturbed much, you know. And then people are traditional about their thinking in real estate, you know. People believe that before I'm 40, I must have a house of my own. You know, if you was in America and you are in real estate, you are in danger. But in Nigeria or in most part of Africa, you can still be comfortable. But I would still advise that people should get still think luxury, because you are going to still have more people, particularly for the type of reward that you want, depending on your size of enterprise. You know, but if you want the big deals to come to you, then you have to also think luxury so that you can set up value for the people in the 1%, right? The people in the 1% are the guys who have the resources to really pay for the quality that you want. So you also want to probably set up a luxury arm. People must understand that there's no advantage in tying with one brand. I mean, you can create options to arrest different parts of the market. I tell people that Pure Milk in Nigeria is also the owner of Three Crowns, right? Pure Milk is the luxury of Three Crowns. The guys, whether you buy Three Crowns or you buy Pure Milk, you are buying from the same company. Whether someone, when people say, I don't like Facebook, I prefer Instagram. Instagram is more quality. Well, whether you like Facebook or Instagram, you are paying Mark Zuckerberg, right? So some people say, I don't like Toyota, I prefer Lexus. Lexus, Toyota, you are paying the same company. You know, so DSTV, GoTV, you are paying the same company. So YouTube, GoTV is for the masses. The other one is for those who can afford it. Pure Milk is for those who can afford it. Three Crown is for everybody. Toyota is for everybody. Lexus for those who can afford it. So you two can create something. Maybe what you are doing now can remain for everybody, but you may also need to think of something for the people that can afford it in the 1%. That kind of idea. Just have to be nimble, open, and really ask those questions that I've mentioned before, and be sure that we are true to answering those questions ourselves.
Great. Great. This was so good. Thank you so much, sir. I mean, I don't see any further questions, right? I mean, I can easily say that we wrap up here, right? What I will do is, this is going to obviously be put out, you know, so people can actually catch on it. But I'll also include the link to your store. I think it's learn.kenneth-orion-store.com.
That's it.
Right? So I will include it, guys. This will be up. This will be up before 12 tomorrow. You'll be able to get it via my YouTube channel. But I'll also include the link to PK's store, so that the materials that he mentioned that would help you, trust me, you don't want to miss out on those materials, right? Everyone that has had it handy, including myself, understand the extent of wisdom that is there and how we can apply it to what we're doing to expand and grow. The truth, if you begin to earn in pounds, for example, you understand how the naira, you know, doesn't have value, as has been explained here, right? The difference is something you would not want to leave, you know, the moment you begin to earn in pounds at all, right? Yeah. And I'm sure it's about the same thing for the dollars as well. Like, you will just realize that what have we been doing in naira, for Christ's sake?
I mean,
you know, you know. So this was great, sir. Thank you so much. And to everyone that has been here, thank you so much. Everyone that has followed from the beginning, thank you so much as well. It was good to have everyone. Thank you so much, sir.
All right, friend. Blessings. All right, sir. I love the doctor and the twins.
No, I will. They were here. All right, sir. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Right. All right, guys. Thank you. As I said, there'll be a YouTube link via my page. Just go through the digital link, and then you see a link to the YouTube channel. You'll get this video there if you want to see the replay. And then I also include Olakunle Soyeon's link to his store, so you can get materials from there as well. Thank you so much for doing this with me. Thank you for following through, for those that followed from beginning to today. I don't take you for granted. I hope to get feedback from you. And if there are questions you need answered, things you want me to respond to, right? Also reach out as well. Thank you. Have a good night.